Good afternoon. So, my official presentation supposedly begins in 10 minutes. I'm supposed to be leading you into some form of meditation. And anybody who has tried to meditate before, you should know that the most challenging time to meditate is right after lunch. So, as we go into a few moments of cultivating stillness, try to maintain a sense of alertness, a sense of vigilance. And of course, if you do fall asleep, try not to snore. That would be the compassionate thing to do for the person next to you. And the second thing is, when we talk about cultivating stillness in meditation, be aware of two things. Firstly, from where I sit, you all look beautiful and wonderful when you close your eyes and you meditate. So don't let the thoughts come across your mind, what my appearance is like. How do I look like? Do I look serene? Do I look tensed? So don't entertain those kinds of thoughts. The second thing is, try not to narrate this experience to yourself. Meaning, when you sit quietly, don't try to talk yourself to sit quietly. He's telling me to sit quietly. I have to think. I have to sit quietly. I have to think of nothing. I have to think of nothing. Oh Lord, I'm thinking about nothing. How to get, you see, that's called narration. You will still have a wonderful experience if you don't narrate this experience to yourself. So, shall we begin? So firstly, simply assuming a comfortable posture. And you can keep your spine straight if it helps. Rest your shoulders. And you can simply rest your eyes gazing at something in front of you, half open, half closed. If you feel more comfortable, keep it closed. And simply begin with a few deep, gentle breaths. Simply try to rest your awareness in this process of breathing in and breathing out. Simply rest your mind in the state of silence, in the state of quietude. Thoughts arise. Try not to follow them or chase them. Simply remind yourself of this moment, this time, now, which is stillness. the stillness. Rest your thoughts. Rest your feelings. Rest your sensations. Simply rest while maintaining a sense of alertness. Gently turn your awareness back to your breath. In this somewhat quiet state, simply give rise to a positive aspiration, such as loving kindness or compassion, fearlessness, and simply hold that aspiration in front of your mind's eye. And simply rest in that aspiration. becoming aware of your breath once again. When you're ready, simply open your eyes and become present. If you wish to take a moment to get up and stretch, please do so now. So for those of you who are simply venturing into meditation, or I should say the world of meditation, one of the things that people are oftentimes not informed about is that meditation is an inherently boring exercise. And when you're firstly venturing into meditation, you have to learn to embrace this boredom. It's a challenging thing to do. All the excitements then follow through. Otherwise, if you're simply looking for excitement in beginning stages of meditation, you'll miss out on the profound boredom that your mind can create. So, I think we'll begin with the next phase of the talk. Right? Okay. And not sure about the timer, so just yell when I'm supposed to be done. In about 3rd century BC, very interesting east-west conversation took place in the frontiers of India, when one of the Greek generals representing Alexander the Great ventured into a forest with his platoon of soldiers. And he came across a semi-naked individual very calmly and happily sitting underneath a tree, looking very content. And this Greek general, like most rude Greek generals, made his presence known, interrupted this guy's meditation, and simply inquired as to what was this person doing. In turn, this meditator looks at the Greek general and says, "What are you doing?" And the Greek general goes on to boast about his accomplishments, how he has been representing Alexander the Great, and has been conquering parts of the world, and has just reached the frontiers of India. When the meditator hears about this, he starts laughing out loud. And the Greek general gets a bit puzzled, and he asked the meditator what was so amusing. And at that point, the meditator asked the Greek general, "In all your conquering, have you conquered your fears? Have you conquered pride? Have you conquered jealousy? More importantly, have you conquered death?" And that was one of the earliest documented East-West conversation. And the reason I begin my presentation with that is to contextualize what does it mean to conquer. What does it mean to be victorious? Or in a layman's term, what does it mean to be a successful leader? What does it mean to be successful? And When we apply meditation, or when we apply any kind of meditative knowledge to this discipline, we have to learn the terrain very well. We have to understand what are the grounds that we are actually trying to approach and what will be the metrics. So I've been teaching at MIT for the past 15 years, and I've been teaching the business school students for the past 7 years, where I created a program called Transformative Leadership. And the program now operates in 8 countries for business leaders, politicians, bureaucrats, technocrats, and alike. And one of the earlier insights that we had when we were running the pilots in a few of the Ivy League business schools was that individuals, when you ask them if they're ethical, and implying that, do you have good values, most of them would actually say yes. Are you kind? Certainly. Are you honest? Yes. And if they were questioning themselves from time to time, they will say, it depends on the circumstances, when you're honest and when you're not. And so then the question becomes, well, what dictates these circumstances? How is it that the mind becomes aware of which circumstance should exercise honesty versus not? So, which leads to a fundamental question, which is, how do leaders make decisions? Is it magical? Is it behavioral? Is it habitual? You see, what is this decision-making processes informed by? But one of the things that we quickly discovered is the level of disconnect. The level of disconnect in terms of people simply assuming that they have a certain set of values, certain criteria of values, versus the ability to actually manifest those values, the ability to exercise those values. You see, it's like this. It's like when we have a compassionate thought, you see, and we take delight in that compassionate thought, and we take delight in the compassionate thought, saying, oh, how wonderful, how marvelous, if something could be done about this. The idea of being compassionate towards somebody, how marvelous it is. And then we look back and say, how marvelous of me to have this compassionate thought. How wonderful of me to actually generate this compassionate thought. And then the next successive moments, we simply relish on our ability to simply generate a compassionate thought. And that oftentimes happens with a lot of values. There's a whole spectrum of values, such as honesty, vision, trust, and so on, where we simply imagine these things. We imagine that we are in it and we are it, and it doesn't manifest itself. It doesn't exercise itself. So there's this level of disconnect. And oftentimes, when you make leaders, business, political, bureaucrats, or MBAs, when you make them aware of this level of disconnect, their response is that of denial or of anger and so on and so forth. So the question then becomes is, how do you integrate this notion of ethics and wisdom in training the next generation of leaders? And I use the word training, and you'll hear me use it quite often. So during my presentation, as the speakers in the morning, I think it was Dr. Siegel, he used the word integration so many times. I take that as a sign of reminder that we are all suffering from subtle chronic schizophrenia. So my presentation will be snippets of certain things. And I'm hoping that you will struggle, because I don't want to deprive you of the joy of struggling, that you will struggle. And upon struggling, you will come to some level or some kind of ability or some understanding of how to actually integrate some of these concepts. What I can assure you is that it is relevant. And we are speaking about it in this forum is because it is relevant. So the question then becomes is, how is it that we begin to think about ethics? And how is it that wisdom actually translates into ethics? And it leads to this keen insight about certain cautionary notes around what happens when people meditate, or what happens when people begin to meditate. And it's a cautionary note simply implying that as much as meditation has the capacity to liberate us of our own afflictive mindsets, or as Bob Marley says, mental slavery, meditation has all those wonderful things, but meditation also has the ability to make us highly self-absorbed. When Father Lawrence was speaking of the etymology of the word meditation, using med as an attention, there's a play, because Greek is part of the Latin Greek is part of the Indo-European language system. Med is to pay attention. Mad is to be intoxicated, to be self-absorbed. And what I mean by self-absorption here is that it's a tool. It's a tool. And it's a tool in a manner that you have to apply with a particular set of intentions in mind. Set of intentions, a set of motivations in mind, meaning that just like anything, any kind of planning that we do, what is it that we wish to accomplish through this process of meditation? Whatever it is that we refer to as meditation. And sometimes the goal is very binary in the sense that I want to accomplish this and I want to get rid of that. And sometimes the goal is quite open, which is the essence of human existence. I have no clue why I'm meditating. I know I have stress level and I have this and that. But at some point, and this our desire to try to find meaning and purpose, at some point we have to suspend these kinds of indicators. We have to suspend the indicators and ask ourselves, well, let's see where this exploration takes me to. Let's see what will happen next. So about a year ago, as part of my job at MIT, I teach also at MIT Media Lab, and we decided to embark on this experiment. And we chose 30 graduate students, wonderfully brilliant people. It's a sell point for MIT. If you ever want to see a really wonderful, vibrant academic environment, you should come there once. And so we get these 30, you see, very brilliant PhD students in a room together. And the course, curiously, at the Media Lab is called Principles of Awareness. And these students are of various backgrounds. Some come from the MBAs from Sloan, some are working in artificial intelligence, some on robotics, some on various kinds of product development. And we simply pose a simple question, which is, let's forget about any definition that we have of awareness. Let's just forget about any knowledge that we have of awareness. And how is it that we want to understand this notion of awareness? More importantly, when we wish to embark on something called self-awareness, this idea that an individual, a consciousness, the mind being aware of itself, the self-awareness, if I did not have the language, if I did not have the vocabulary of either the secular, the religious, or the spiritual world, how would I experience this awareness? How would I understand this awareness? And we had a brilliant six months in which people sort of ventured into different kinds of exercises, different kinds of ways or methods of looking at the mind, looking at their experiences, analyzing it, and then blogging about it. And then from those kinds of blogs, we went back into these modes of reflection as to, you see, what are these awareness, what are these experiences teaching them? And one thing that became quite apparent was that self-awareness is also, in certain ways, at least in beginning stages, a skill set. A skill set implying that our mind oftentimes is simply so occupied or preoccupied that it fails to exercise any notion of self-awareness, meaning what is going on in my mind, what is informing my decisions, what emotional state I am in, and more importantly, looking at what are going to be the consequences of any particular kinds of decisions that we are making. Part two of things. As we started embarking on this program on leadership, and when we went around various business schools and business organizations, one thing that became quite curious was that a lot of organizations pay a lot of money to put big, bold visions. This organization believes in so-and-so, this thing does this and this, and so on. And when we did a survey of all the mid-level to high-level executives, including the board members of the organization, not a single one of them actually remembered the entirety of their vision statement. So you ask a simple question that we are trying to reform or reframe the culture of an organization. What role does a vision statement play? Is it there simply as a marketing gimmick? Is it there to show people? Or is it there actually to influence the internal culture of the organization? The second thing is the level of disconnect. Again, that simply because we have good sounding words, good vocabulary in our vision statements, does not necessarily translate into people actually having a buy into those kinds of vision statements. Meaning people need to be trained, people need to go through the understanding of why do I work for an organization that has this vision statement? This leads to the next issue, which is around meaning. So one of my colleagues, Zeynep, did some remarkable work with Costco and a couple of other companies, where she wanted to talk about meaning, and not meaning in the existential Kierkegaardian sense of the word meaning, but meaning in day-to-day life, when we go to work, you see. And they brought together, you know, a bunch of janitors, for example, the janitors who simply mop and clean and so on. And oftentimes they would look rather depressed about the job they were doing. And initially when you ask them, you know, what's the value of your work? Their immediate response oftentimes will be, well, it has no value. I get paid in peanuts. Nobody appreciates me. Nobody appreciates my work. Next question you ask is, how do you perceive your work? Well, it's not a question of perception of work, because other people, you know, I mop the floor, and then they put on their dirty shoes, and they just walk across the floor, and they undo everything I've done, and so on. They push the question a bit more further, and you say, that's all fine. That's all correct. But what do you think you're really doing in this organization? And I'm starting with the lowest level, you know, factor in an organization, the janitors. And a week goes by, and they start to have some kind of conversation among themselves during lunchtime as to what is the meaning of their work? What does it mean to be a janitor? And then suddenly, a week later, when they start the conversation again, they say, oh, I have discovered something. We ask what? And they said, well, I've discovered that I'm not just mopping the floor. I am creating a clean, safe, hygienic condition for others. A clean, safe, hygienic condition for others. Then another janitor spoke about how this clean space allows for people to grow, allows for people to have a clean and healthy mind, and so on and so forth. 2 months later, when the organization did the survey in terms of contentment, satisfaction, job happiness of these janitors, it had soared very high. And it's not that the company had invested too much money in them. What the company had actually invested in was providing them with an avenue, a platform to explore the sense of meaning or the sense of purpose. What are they actually doing? And if we can find a sense of meaning and a sense of purpose in one of the lowest common jobs in the world, I'm sure we can do that with other things as well. So the question is, can we actually reflect on why we do what we do? More than in terms of what is it that I'm deriving out of it? Moving on to the next thing, which has to do with this idea of any technique, whether it's meditation and so on, and any qualities of leadership that you learn about. We are conditioned to have relationships with things that are very transactional in nature. We as human beings have rarely experienced a relationship that is not transactional. We like to use flowery language about it, you know, how I love somebody, how I care for somebody, you see. But when you actually reflect on it, and when you analyze it, you will recognize that at the end of that analysis lies some kind of transaction. So of course, it's an exercise that requires radical honesty, and I invite you to do that exercise with any kind of relationship with an individual, with an idea, with an object that you have, which is that all relationships become transactional in that manner. So habitually, we are driven to take any kind of discipline, whether it has to do with cultivating wisdom, whether it has to do with cultivating stillness. The mind is still thinking in terms of the transactional nature. What is the input and what is going to be the output of it? And at times, what science has done and what my colleagues, you know, in brain and cognitive have shown you are some of the key indicators of what meditation can do. And it is wonderful, and the scientific exploration will continue, and we'll continue to discover new things about it. But at the end of the day, you still have to ask yourself, are you able to suspend some of the transactional nature of things? Meaning that, can you think of meaning and purpose in a non-transactional manner? So we talk about compassion, and we talk about compassion cultivation. It's transactional. Can you cultivate a kind of compassion that is not transactional? Can you cultivate a kind of compassion where compassion is simply oozing out of you, as you ooze sweat in this hot weather of Singapore, you see? Just oozing out of you naturally. And it's oozing out of you naturally through every pore of your being, and it influences everybody around you, you see? That's a different level of compassion than a compassion where the mind is simply calculating what's my input and what's going to be my output. So it's important for leaders to have those kinds of aspirations in their life as well. I'm a firm believer that all human beings are contemplatives. It doesn't matter whether you believe in a religious system or a religious framework or not, you are contemplatives. Anytime you have asked the question pertaining to your existence, pertaining to somebody else's existence, it's a contemplative question. The question, of course, the issue becomes, what do you do with that question next? And that's where I believe some of these frameworks are useful to think about. And oftentimes we do tend to sort of overcomplicate some of these ideas. For example, this notion of responsibility or the notion of stewardship, that is another commonly thrown around terms around leadership. I want to tell you a story. As you heard, you know, I ran away from home when I was 10. So 2 years prior to my running away, I was about 8 years or so, and I was taking a leisurely walk one summer in my village. And I was taking this walk, and I see a very elderly gentleman planting some kind of tree. And he had planted, you know, I think about 15 or 20 such trees all along the street. Along the street meaning that it wasn't his private property, it was just public property. And I, being the 8-year-old inquisitive person, approached this elderly man. I asked him, "Baba, what are you doing?" He said, "Well, I'm planting trees." "What kind of trees are they?" "Well, they're mango trees." Then I said, "Well, how long will it take until the fruits come out?" He said, "Well, 3 years, but maybe the first round is not going to be that good. Maybe 5 years, by 50 it'll have, you know, very sweet fruit." So this is the 8-year-old calculated mind. Next question, "Baba, how old are you?" And he says, "Oh, well, I'm about 92 years old. So I said, "Are you going to be around in the next 5 years?" And I still remember this distinct smile. He smiled with one tooth hanging. One tooth hanging. And he said, "I won't be, but you will be. I won't be, but you will be." And I think, as a species, I fear that we are losing our ability to think long term. That we are losing that kind of ability where we put an effort and we say, "I may not see the results in the next 6 months, in the next quarter, but the future generation is going to see the results, and the future generation is actually going to enjoy the fruits of my labor." It doesn't imply that one should become self-sacrificial. Altruism, too, in our society is very transactional, very calculated. But the ability to suspend the returns on immediate investments, the ability to suspend that idea and begin to think long term, to begin to think what could happen 25 years, 50 years from now for the efforts that I'm making today. So this illiterate, uneducated, old Indian villager had the idea of what it means to be a steward of resources that are available to him at that moment in time and space. So the question is, what is available to us, whether we are able to mindfully utilize it in a manner where we can actually create a culture of thrive and a culture of flourishing. So maybe I'll take a pause there, because I was told about giving an opportunity for a Q&A session. So maybe I'll take a pause there, and then perhaps we can have some kind of conversation.
Could we have another story when you were 8 years old?
Not 8 year old. I'll tell you another story when I was 11 and a half year old. My mind has very good markers in terms of incidents and events that become an inspiration. For a year and a half, from the age of 10 to 11 and a half, so I have a very good fortune of studying with some of the best, most wonderful, most kind teachers in the world. Great fortune. And by 11 and a half, I had received all kinds of transmissions and studied in depth about compassion. I thought I knew all that is there to know about compassion. I could recite texts, I could tell you the ideas, I could, in fact, even give you exercises for cultivating compassion. I was, in a layman's term, an adept in compassion at 11 and a half. I gave my first public teaching when I was 12. I come back to Calcutta, and I meet this woman, a very tiny woman, and I'm following her around. I'm told that she's doing compassionate things. So I want to observe her work. And this woman completely shattered everything that I knew about compassion. Mother Teresa, most profound woman, one of the most profound teachers I've had. The ability, you see, to find meaning in even smallest thing, in things that people dismiss. You see, often things what we don't recognize about leaders, or in our world, most leaders that become saintly figures, is how were they before the spotlight dawned on them? How were they before they were in the media? How were they before they got the Nobel Prize and so on? Meaning looking at the struggle of these individuals. We seldom pay attention to these kinds of stories. So Mother Teresa, from morning to night, diligently, oftentimes she would have struggled with her faith, struggled with what she believed in. But nonetheless, not finding it as an excuse, not rationalizing it, but day in and day out, making effort, not thinking at that moment what kind of social impact her work was having. She was dealing with one leper at a time. One leper at a time. That then created this grand organization called Missionaries of Charity. I'll tell you one story that happened during that course, during my time with her. We went into one of the slums, and there were a bunch of donors from overseas who had come, and you know, they wanted to see what the work in slums was like and so on. And then one single mother came out from the house with four very young kids. And one of the donors was very overwhelmed. He was so overwhelmed that he took out his wallet, took out all the cash that he had, a wardload of cash, and just gave it to this woman. What happened next was unfathomable. This woman takes the cash, and she starts calling out names of other women. And as they come around, she starts to share this money that she just received, that she needs most desperately for herself and her kids. You see, she started to share it with others. Not an individual who's trained in compassion, not an individual who thinks so much about altruism, but she had the uncanny ability to share the resources, share what she had. And it's a question, you see, I often ask individuals as we go into, you know, the various kinds of leadership training and all this thing. And the question, again, as Father Lawrence raised early on, is the question of meaning and the question of purpose, which is, what trajectory do you want to give this leadership path for yourself? Because, you know, it's like that, wonderful anecdote with Michelangelo. When people ask Michelangelo, they say, how do you carve such beautiful sculpture out of marble slabs, out of marble rocks? And Michelangelo's response was, no. The sculpture is already in there. I just chisel away the waste. The sculpture is already in there. I just chisel away the waste. And I think when we think of leadership, maybe we can learn something from the analogy that when we talk about leadership, we have the ability, we have the criteria, we have certain skill sets. How do we chisel away all the other obstacles? How do we chisel away all the other obscurations that are preventing me from reaching my true potential of becoming a good leader?
Sir, I wish to go back to your story about Mother Teresa. What this poor lady did to me was a purely transactional-based gesture. Okay, she was, in that giving, she was ensuring her continued long-term security with this group that she lived with. So what was so unfathomable about that?
I don't know what you mean by long-term security in that regard.
Who was she giving the money to?
She wasn't giving money, actually. She wasn't giving money. You see, this is one of the things that we often do is when we don't observe things closely, you see, we simply pay attention to things. Mother Teresa actually never interacted with money or cash.
No, I'm not talking about Mother Teresa, the poor lady who was sharing the money that she got.
Well, she gave it to, she just called her neighbors and all
these people. Exactly, her neighbors.
Right, right.
So her neighbors are, to some degree, her security system. She can either keep them upset or she can win their favor. When you're as poor and as vulnerable as that, your neighbors are your extended family, or it's wise to treat your neighbors as your extended family.
Well, that's a good logic. I mean,
okay.
So it's not a question of whether her interaction was transactional or not. All I'm saying is that she was in desperate need. She didn't have to share. She did not share, but she did. She made that choice.
I feel that she got more by sharing, and therefore it wasn't unfathomable at
See,
all.
But that's what I'm saying is that that's how we tend to rationalize. That's how we tend to rationalize every single gesture of ours. And I'm simply suggesting is, can we think of a mind that is not prone to these kinds of rationalizations of how we explain a particular experience to ourselves?
Thank you for your talk. Would you be able to share some of your insights of the students that you're teaching now?
Let's see, we are working on a grand project on empathy at the moment. And you see, the neat thing about MIT students is it doesn't matter whether you're a Nobel laureate or not. If they have a disagreement, they will tell you they have a disagreement. And it's a beautiful feeling, meaning that it's wonderful to be in an environment that is irreverent for the right reasons. So in terms of insights, there is, you know, when people, you know, a lot of my students have had successful startups and designed certain kinds of products. So one of the hot industries right now is wearables, wearable technology, and there's a lot of work going on in terms of designing wearable technology to promote certain kinds of contemplative experiences and so on. And so, you know, the new areas that we are venturing into is where people are deeply looking into this idea of, well, you know, what is truly measurable? How do we design the readings for measurable? And more importantly, how do we deal with things that are immeasurable? You see? Because immeasurable does not translate into having no value. In fact, some of the most deepest experiences, deepest relationships in your life are immeasurable. So it's not a question that it has no value, but then the issue becomes, how do I translate into having a value? And if I cannot translate into having a metric, how do I accept that experience? How do I think about that experience and so on? So those are some of the questions that we are now venturing into. In addition to venturing into some bold ideas as to how do you create a mass empathy experience for 20,000 people at a time. That if you're talking about triggering certain kinds of experiences, how do you trigger that for mass?
Hi, Tenzin. This is Zhang here. I'm very glad to hear you talk. And I'm very interested to know what do you think mindfulness is within the arena of AI? Because you said you worked with a lot of AI professionals in MIT, in Media Lab, and I am also working on AI, and I'm very, very interested to know your viewpoint. And the other question I have for you is that you mentioned you ran away from home at 10 years old, and I am very, very interested to know, like, your viewpoint on family and family reconciliation. Yep, thank you so much.
I should have given a disclaimer, don't ask difficult questions. With the AI, actually, rather than going so much into it, I would suggest if you have time next year, we'll be holding a conference at MIT on AI. I think it's in April sometime. So you'll get more understanding there. But the question, you know, of course, is, you know, if these are the metrics that we are talking about, awareness and meditation and mindfulness and all, are those not the kinds of metrics that can be applied to an AI system? So what is different? What is different in the broader basis of mindfulness versus this? See, the other thing is that you have to be, you know, this event, as Meng earlier on said, is historical. It's historical in the sense that, you know, it's the first time that a group of keen individuals, a group of keen seekers have gathered together under one roof to explore, to truly explore, you see, what is this world of mindfulness? What is the discipline of mindfulness? And more importantly, how can we translate it into creating better leaders, therefore better organizations and better societies? But one of the things that we have to do is also be curious about, you see, what would certain discipline lead into? You see, for example, you know, the reason I had to talk about ethics and ethical framework in the beginning, in terms of contextualizing the idea of wisdom and so on, is that we don't have actually any data. You know, we did a conference called Rethinking Mindfulness. I think Meng was there. Rethinking Mindfulness last year at MIT, where we invited, you know, Jon Kabat-Zinn, Alan, Meng, and everybody who's there thinking and talking about mindfulness. And one of the things that we recognize is, you know, that in the last 10 years, of course, there have been, you know, plethora of documents published on mindfulness. But there is actually no data suggesting that people who practice mindfulness actually become good human beings, that they become actually kind human beings, they actually become caring human beings. That is, there's not an objective data on that. Now Jon Kabat-Zinn and his people, just a couple of months ago, actually, they have embarked and they have actually announced this research. Because in 2008, 2009, this became a major concern. You see, this became a major concern when we were looking into interventions, or designing intervention programs into making business organizations more responsible. We actually came to recognize that a lot of, you see, wonderful people, bankers, people who were leading financial world, were actually long-term mindful practitioners in their own right. They had been practicing mindfulness for 25 years or so. Same goes for CEOs of pharmaceutical industries. Now, the question then becomes is, it is true that they are deriving certain benefits of mindfulness practice. You see, there's no doubt about that. The question is that, are those benefits sufficient, or do we need to contextualize it in a manner that the benefits can be translated at a much more mass scale? Meaning, will it make people more responsible? Will it make people truly understand interconnectedness in a manner of taking a sense of responsibility for the other? So this is what I mean by, you know, partly distinction in terms of this exploration. Thanks.
So, really great. And I want to point to what you were just talking about. When you were discussing your colleague who went into an organization to help transform that organization, and you said the brand was Costco, my heart sunk.
Not to transform that organization, to study that organization.
Okay,
there's a
great
distinction between study and transformation. Academics very rarely seek to transform. They love to observe. They love to study. Very rarely they go into the transformation business.
But they had the chance to actually do. They did have the chance to actually transform the janitors.
But it was one-off experience, I would say. But what the research did do was it inspired other companies to actually look into it more deeply. You see, the thing is, When we talk about East and West, it also has to talk about, you know, the clash of values, the clash of what does it mean to do business as usual. You see? So, for example, conducting business as usual in the United States versus conducting business as usual in India or other places. And now that we live in a global village where we are actually transferring leaderships, you know, we have an Indian heading Microsoft, you see? And we have Americans heading Indian organizations or Singaporean organizations. The question still is that how are the values of the organizations influenced by that culture? How do they relate to that culture? Because the massive number of employees working for any other organization will be natives. So there are times when it has backfired, like Walmart's work in Mexico has backfired in a manner where they actually tried to cater to the mindset of corruption, because they thought that was business as usual in that culture. So it's a question of recognition at times.
Yeah, so but what I'm trying to point to, or what I'm trying to dig into, is if meditation and mindfulness is not what makes the difference to create compassion and the longer view of planting the mango tree, what is going to make the difference to have ethics thrive inside of the hearts and the minds of the leaders that we are cultivating today?
Let me be clear. I did not say that meditation and mindfulness is not the way. Meditation and mindfulness is a way. And it's not a question of whether meditation and mindfulness would catalyze that kind of leadership qualities. The thing is, how, it's not what you teach, it is how you teach it. Not what you teach, how you teach it. And that's where the context becomes important. So I can give you, you know, an 8-week session on meditation that will make you feel on top of the world, and you'll be the most self-absorbed, self-preoccupied individual in the world. And I can give you a certification for that too, if you so desire at that moment. But the question is, again, the same techniques can be taught in a manner where you come out as most caring, most kind, most wonderful, most reflective, responsible to yourself and others. Similar programs, but it has to be taught with particular mechanisms in mind, certain parameters in mind. This is with any skill sets. You see, one of the, you know, we talk about calm abiding, and one of the arguments oftentimes is snipers have calm abiding. They're very focused, they have tremendous sense of attention, and one can argue that we want similar kinds of skill sets in our professionals as well, as well. But the question becomes that how do we contextualize it for particular professions, particular groups of people, so that we can optimize. So here you have to think of ethics as optimization, not just as right or wrong, but as an optimization criteria. I'm getting signals. Thank you so very much.